Good morning, everybody. You will have to forgive me if I start coughing or doing other disgusting things. I'm suffering from a little bit of a cold. But I am super excited to be here talking to all of you. This is my first keynote as well, so a little nervous, but I'm sure I'll be fine. My talk is titled How to Stay in Love with Programming, and it is a personal history. So, we are all here because we are passionate people. And programming is our passion, or technology, what have you. Programming is also one of the few passions that you can really easy carry into a pretty freaking awesome career, if I do say so myself. On the other hand, there is the saying that, you know, the quickest way to lose interest in something is to make it your job. So, you know, I've been thinking a lot about how do you maintain that passion and joy that you feel, you know, sort of early in your career when you first start really learning programming. And I figured that I would share the story of my journey. So, you know, write what you know. I'm so happy that Mike's keynote is sort of a little bit his journey, right? Mike and I have slightly different journeys into programming and slightly different interests. And I think in many ways our talks are a little bit of a yin and yang, right? We have, you know, sort of some core things in common and some things very, very different. Mike's talk was about all the obsession. My talk is a little bit more about observation. That's been sort of my key to advancement. But I hope that you, between the two of us, you guys will get, you know, something out of these talks. Because, you know, programming is magic. I mean, it really is. It's like the closest thing to feeling like a wizard, I think, in this modern day is programming. I mean, we've seen all of these amazing talks yesterday, more today. They're just like, you did what with what? Like, you made that, you used awk and you made sound, like, and like all these other amazing things. Like, that's really, really awesome. Programming is one of the few things that you can do where you can touch so many people with, you know, relatively little effort. So it's pretty awesome, but, you know, truth be told, nothing is easy. And it can be extremely discouraging at times. And I have had many ups and downs in my careers, not only these sort of micro ups and downs of cursing at code, which everyone here who has worked with me has heard me do many, many times, but also sort of the ups and downs of just like, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? Am I any good at it? What's going on here? So, what's the secret? Staying in love, you know, through good times and bad, richer and poorer, sickness and health, till death do you part, right? Because the secret of programming is that programming doesn't love you back. That's the truth, right? You love programming, programming does not love you back. So it has to be about you. It has to be about your own personal journey to love, because that's the only way you're going to maintain this. So what's my personal journey? Well, we begin at the beginning, and you know, the beginning with love is generally infatuation, and you know, in my case also frequently frustration. For me, falling in love was relatively easy. So I've been, you know, a nerd for a long time. I like to say that, you know, I fell in love with computers in like third grade doing logo, and I started programming a little bit in high school. And, you know, I went to college for computer science. Like, I went to college at Carnegie Mellon, which many of you here actually went there as well. And that's a program where you apply and you go to the School of Computer Science. And I was bound and determined to be a computer scientist as of my freshman year of college. And I fell in love, might say, more with the idea of programming than with programming itself. Because especially when I was in college, programming was really hard. It's gotten slightly easier, I think, in the time since I started programming. I was actually thinking, and I forgot to look this up, but I suspect that, you know, the time between now and when I sort of started is almost as long as the time between when I started and when C++ was invented. So, maybe even C. So it's like a long, you know, programming has hopefully evolved several notches in that interim period. But I fell in love with many different ideas of programming. So first, I thought I would be an AI person because I read a lot of cyberpunk. I was like, really love Neuromancer, yeah. Snow Crash. I was like, yes, I'm going to make like intelligent computers. And then I took an AI course and I was like, maybe not so much. I'm like, oh, maybe like theory and algorithms. No, I'm not good at theory and algorithms. I was at Carnegie Mellon, so programming languages. Programming languages are definitely the thing. I'm not that good at programming. I was not bad, and I took a lot of classes in it, but I wasn't actually that good at it. So I was like, got to the end of my career, my undergrad, I was like, all right, compilers. Compilers are where it's at. I'm pretty good at low-level stuff, and this is fun. So I was like, this is what I'm going to be into. And I took a job doing sort of compiler-y debugging tools. Well, that was, you know, cool. I kind of got through undergrad partly through sheer determination. And took this job and floundered badly. For like a year and a half, I basically did not, I would say I did not get much done. And it was really hard, actually. Looking back, you know, I didn't have great mentorship in that job, but I just like, I was like, oh my God, maybe this is like scary. So I was like, okay, that's fine, I'll go to grad school. Because, you know, I can be a grad student, I'm smart. You know, I had some research interests. I'm gonna go to grad school and I'm gonna work in like compilers and it'll be awesome. And I got to grad school, and I was like, all right, compilers. Wasn't any good at that. So I was like, okay, I'm going to switch to computer architecture and a little bit of operating systems. And in fact, I was pretty good in a course called distributed systems. But when I was in graduate school, distributed systems were not very cool. That was just like not an interesting area to pursue at the time, so I thought. And so I sort of got to the end of like a master's degree, and I was like, this is not good. Like, I'm not a good graduate student. I didn't do very well in this job. I've had countless internships that have all been fine, but what do you really get out of that? I was beginning to wonder if I had made a terrible mistake, and maybe programming and tech was just not for me. So I did a very drastic thing, which was I took the LSATs and thought about going to law school. Fortunately, I am a very practical person, and I was like, there is no way I'm jumping from graduate school straight to law school. That's crazy. I have to give it one more shot. So I decided that I was going to move to New York City. And I was like, I don't even care all that much where I work, as long as I'm working someplace where like I can get paid enough to live in New York City. And this was actually amazing. So I got a job at a company called Goldman Sachs, which I had literally never heard of until I interviewed with them. Don't tell Goldman, because one thing I learned for that interview was that you have to tell them how awesome Goldman Sachs is when you interview. I don't think that's true anymore, but it was true when I interviewed. You know, but I took this job at Goldman Sachs, and I did something sort of very lucky happened to me then, which was that I didn't know anything about finance, and I had kind of hit bottom with my own sort of self-confidence, like, oh, I'm not good at any of these things that I feel like I should be good at. So here's what I'm gonna do. I just let go of my assumptions. And I went to this job and I was like, I'm gonna be dumb. I'm gonna ask a lot of dumb questions. If I don't understand something perfectly, I'm gonna ask questions until I do. And this turned out to be kind of an amazing thing. So if you've ever studied Buddhism, you're probably familiar with the concept of beginner's mind. Beginner's mind, this is my son, by the way. Beginner's mind is like the mind of a child first learning. It's this mind where you're sort of an empty vessel, and all you're doing is observing and taking things in without prejudice, without thinking that you know what's right or what's wrong, just sort of observing and learning and being open to new ideas. And for me, this was incredibly freeing, because up until this point in my career, I feel like I had been dominated by shoulds. I should be good at programming languages. I should be a good grad student. I should be able to do it all without help. I should know everything. I should be working in C, C++, and doing like awesome tech company stuff. And I was like, you know what? None of those things were working out for me. So I'm just gonna like give this a shot. And in reality, what I discovered when I did this was that I had no idea what I wanted to do. I had no idea. All these shoulds had been making me miserable. And I had been judging myself. I had no idea what was hard and what wasn't. I had no idea what was cool and what wasn't. Again, distributed systems, that class that I was good at in graduate school, ended up being something that I've worked on in this job and is now like the hotness, right? Like I coincidentally happen to be very good at this thing that now everybody thinks is really cool. But that was totally accidental for me. I discovered that I actually really like, you know, working in an iterative way, which was very different at the time from like traditional tech company. I was working at Microsoft earlier, right, where you like are building software that's going to ship in all one big bang for years and years and years you're building. I loved this iterative style of building. I loved building with a business purpose in mind, actually. I really enjoyed that. And this was really freeing for me, because I actually started to discover what I was good at and what I enjoy. It also let me focus a lot. So you know, I discovered that I sort of liked it, and I started to focus on what I was doing. I was like, all right, like, this is actually kind of cool. Like, I'm actually kind of good at this. I'm focusing on it. I started to really learn my tools. I learned the intricacies of Java. I like to say that unit testing saved my life. Until this job, no one had ever taught me how to test anything. And I still cannot believe that. It still blows my mind to this day that it took until, you know, 2005 for me to learn about testing. How did anybody ever get anything done before that? Like, you had to, like, have it all in your head, right? You had this whole program in your, okay, print line debugging. I did a lot of that. I still do a little bit of that. But I all of a sudden, like, unit testing, like, freed me to actually get things done. I learned, you know, all about garbage collection. I learned about how to use an IDE and actually make it useful. And if you're writing Java code, a good IDE is really useful. I had some good mentors along the way who helped me with this focus. And sometime a few years into that job, something like amazing happened. I found this confidence that I had not had before. You know, Julie Andrews, I have confidence in sunshine. The obstacle between me and problems stopped being me. And I achieved something that I think is incredibly important for me, at least, in staying in love with programming, which is mastery. What is mastery? What does it look like? The thing that I will say about mastery, number one, is that mastery does not come fast and does not come cheap. You are not guaranteed mastery because you have a great undergrad or a graduate degree or anything. Mastery took me about 10 years to achieve. I'm not saying that's how long it will take everyone or anyone. I'm just saying that for me, it took a long time. And it took a long time and it took a lot of focus. Mastery, in my mind, looks like it manifests itself as confidence. But to achieve it, it looks like really, really learning your tools, taking the time to pick some language or a couple of languages, and really just understanding them soup to nuts in a way that lets you get shit done really well. It means understanding the memory model, understanding the garbage collector or the standard template library to a level that, like, you know, most people don't really care that much, right? Understanding what the global interpreter lock means for your programs, understanding understanding enough that you have to do a minimal amount of yak shaving to get any new thing done in a particular language. Mastery to me is really important and really valuable because it will sustain you throughout your career. So, you know, I was introduced as, you know, an Apache Zookeeper person, which is true, and a VP of engineering, which is also true. My job right now, I do not write code very much. Pretty much only in extreme anger. Occasionally, I fix alerts. That's kind of like the limit of my programming these days. But I feel confident because I have this mastery that if I ever need to go back into programming all day, every day, I can totally do it. Nobody's ever gonna tell me, Camille, you're not technical enough. Nobody would ever say that to me because I have this sort of, I have this experience and I have this mastery. And I think that achieving mastery, and you will achieve mastery, if you keep at it, you will achieve it, is one of the key parts to staying in love with programming because it just gives you, it's just sort of the bedrock of love. But it's key, but it's not the only thing. So, as you continue in your career, other things are going to become important in a way that they aren't when you're still in this really like rapid growth early stage. And those two things in my mind are really authenticity and purpose. So, more recently in my career, I had achieved mastery, I was at Goldman, I was doing some pretty awesome things. This is actually the period of time when I was building giant systems in Zookeeper and, you know, really working on big, hard technical problems. I was also miserable, and in fact, I was so miserable, my friends and I refer to that as the bitchy years, because I was, like, actually sort of taking it out on everyone around me in a way that, like, we kind of had to have an intervention for me. And it's weird because I was working on, generally speaking, things I liked, but I was just very unhappy. And so I did a lot of introspection and tried to figure out what in the world's going on, and I realized that I had a fundamental value misalignment with Goldman Sachs. So anyone who has ever worked with me or for me knows that one of my biggest core values is transparency. I am a transparent person. I want to work in public. I want to talk about what I work. I want to be able to do open source programming. I want to be able to tweet random shit. I want to be able to write blog posts about what I'm doing and share that with the world. I am a, you know, citizen of the world. I'm not a citizen of any particular company. And finance is not a great place for that. They actually were very, like, they let me. I worked in open source at Goldman, but not everybody could do that. And that bothered me. I wanted to be somewhere where anybody that wanted to do that could do that. So I was in this value misalignment at Goldman, and I realized that, like, you know what? I need to find some place where I can be a little more aligned with what I value. And so finding my values and actually sort of going towards them was important for me in being happy. It's important that everybody realize that you are allowed to be you. You gotta do you. You cannot do anything but you. In particular, you're allowed to be creative in your own way. Another thing I realized in the last, like, literally the last couple of years is that I am a creative person. For a long time, I really thought that I wasn't, because I'm not an inventor. I'm not a blank canvas creator. I'm not an amazing side projects person. So many of you here are people that just, like, open up, you know, your editor and create something amazing from scratch. That is not me. I am a creative problem solver. You know, Mike's keynote yesterday was super awesome, and I wish that I could be like that guy, Harry. I wish that I could be like Mike, frankly, because, man, like, you know, that's like a really cool, creative, like, you know, inventive sort of way to be, but I'm not that person. I am a problem solver, and I have to, you know, accept that. But I also have to accept that you don't have to be original to be creative. You can be creative in, you know, your own way. So be yourself, right? You're allowed to be yourself. You're allowed to be a little cynical if you want to be a little cynical. Not too cynical, but a little cynical. Right? You should expose yourself to new things so that you're continuing to learn new things and you don't just sort of stand on the old stuff you know. But sometimes exposing yourself to new things is just mostly about, you know, reminding yourself how the old stuff isn't that bad. And the last thing I want to say in context of freeing to be you is that side projects are really not a requirement. You don't have to work in open source if you don't want to. You don't have to do side projects. You don't. It's really, really, really not required. It doesn't mean you're a bad programmer. I know a million amazing programmers who have never done a side project. They have other things that they like to do in their spare time. That doesn't mean that people that do side projects aren't good programmers either. Everybody, you know, can be a good programmer, but you have to be a good programmer in your own way. A lot of people, when I asked, like, how do you stay in love with programming, they did say side projects, because that is an important thing for many people, but it's not a requirement for everyone. So finally, I think the last thing I will say about staying in love is that it's really important to find purpose in what you do. Now, what do I mean by this? You do not have to work for a company whose purpose you love. You don't have to work for Spotify if you love music. You can love music and work for a company that does nothing related to music. So, as I said, programming is magic. And if you want to stay in love with programming, rely on growth to give you confidence, authenticity to align your values and be true to yourself, and purpose to direct your passions and go outside yourself and see the world through others' eyes. And I believe these things can help you stay in love with programming and have an amazing career throughout the years. Thank you very much.